The problem with settling into the comfort of our own worlds is that everything can change in the blink of an eye.
Thank you so much for clicking on this video. I'm Brooke Makenna, and today we are talking about a tiny village in France that all of a sudden went completely insane. And the theories around this one, there's a lot. And there's a lot of theories that it could possibly have been a CIA secret experiment, or that it was just a bad case of food poisoning. So let's get into what happened in Pont-Saint-Esprit in 1951. And if I'm pronouncing anything incorrectly, I do not know French, so please be nice in the comments below. So this small village of Pont-Saint-Esprit in France was known for just being peaceful and relaxing and a place where people could go and just feel nice. No bad crime rates, nothing horrible. The city was just beautiful, clean, fresh, basically. And that was until August 15th of 1951, where everything slowly and then quickly began to change. So this is when one after the other people in this town started getting violently ill with this strange illness that they had never heard of before, that nobody in this town had had before, and that the symptoms were extremely, extremely aggressive. So this illness started off as a regular illness, people were coming in with nausea, stomach cramps, diarrhea, vomiting, and so the doctors just thought, okay, something in the area is bad. And they all had just like a mild case of food poisoning, but then a few days later, the hallucinations began. And I mean, these were serious hallucinations, like bad enough that some people were sent to mental asylums. There were three doctors in this town with offices, and every single one's waiting room was completely full during this time. And at first they really didn't think anything of it. They just thought, okay, some illness is going around, it'll be gone in a little while. But after these hallucinations started, they were very, very, very concerned, but still kind of thinking, it's just food poisoning, it's just people in these towns are just affected differently, and so they didn't really alert anyone about this happening. But after a few days, the symptoms began kind of getting better. Some people were experiencing extreme tiredness or insomnia. Everyone was like, ah, okay, everything's getting better, it's gonna be fine. And then it came back. So these people that were experiencing this illness before and seemed fine, about 48 hours later, after they had been cleared of this illness, it came back, and it was even worse. These hallucinations included fire and multicolored animals and just these strangest things that these people could see. These hallucinations were vivid enough that people would walk around and just, like, they were in a trance of some sort. Like, they were in a completely different world and could see such different things than everybody else, but they swore that they were real. A journalist actually heard a man who was dealing with this illness scream, "I'm dead. There's copper in my head and snakes in my stomach." And he was not kidding. He actually thought that this was real. Along with a little girl who believed she was being attacked by tigers, and a little boy named Charles who strangled his mother, or tried to. And that's not normal for a sickness. So on August 24th, only not even 10 days after this all began, it got even worse. And there were people that had been taken to hospitals to keep held until they stopped experiencing hallucinations that were now jumping from the windows and trying to commit suicide and banging their head violently on the tables and trying to get out of their cuffs because they wanted to be free. And this man actually that tried to jump out of a window and commit suicide, he wasn't really doing it to commit suicide. He thought he was a plane. And that is legitimately what he thought. And he survived and broke his leg, but got up like nothing was wrong and just started running for no reason. So basically this entire town, they had gone insane like that. Like all of a sudden, this entire town that was calm and peaceful and mostly sane, they all just lost every marble that they could have possibly had. Unfortunately, there were five dead within weeks and two possible suicides that had also happened. And everyone in this town was experiencing these same things. and it was unknown what was happening or if every single one of them were going to die, if this was like the new plague or if it just caused certain people to die and certain people to just be a little ill. They had no idea. They didn't know what was happening whatsoever, and nobody had answers, not even doctors. So the first thing they thought to do was blame the baker in the area because he was the one that supplied everyone with food, and all of the victims said that yes, they ate from this baker. So this master baker of this village was arrested, and bread was banned, and it was called cursed bread because it was thought that it had done this. It had caused everything. So the theory with the bread was that there was a fungus within the bread that happened when they took the flour, and it had contaminated rye in it and basically created this fungus inside the bread that was killing and infecting them all. So the actual official name for this fungus and this poisoning was ergot poisoning. And that is what the doctor of this town blamed the entire illness on, even wrote an article about it saying that that was all that this was and that it would pass hopefully soon and that all bread was banned and this baker was being arrested and that it was all fine and dandy. But nobody really believed that. Ergot hadn't shown up anywhere since the 18th century as far as poisoning or being in flour or being in the grain or anything. It just hadn't been talked about since the 18th century. With the evidence of the victims all saying that they ate this bread, the doctors in the town thought that that was going to be the end of it, but there were more tests that were completed either overseas or just without their approval. There was a man named Albert Hoffman that actually had discovered that ergot fungus could be synthesized or chemically made into LSD, just a synthesized version of LSD. So he came down to see if this is possibly what happened, and possibly someone had created this ergot, but really it was LSD to do something to this entire village. Once he was there, he said that yes, this was a huge possibility that this is what had happened. But when he went back home and went back to work at Sandoz Laboratory, he recanted his statement and said, no, that's probably not the possibility. You guys need to find something else. Which was very, very suspicious. But we'll come back to Sandoz Laboratories in a little bit. So then an American laboratory actually did investigations on this as well and did some experiments. So they took this ergot fungus, placed it in bread, and fed it to volunteers, and none were reported to have the same symptoms as the people in this village. So at this point, nobody knew what had happened in 1951 to create this mass insanity that had happened, and these poor victims that had died or went through this and their families had no answers other than like a sad possibility that because they ate bread, they lost a family member. Or because they ate bread, they went crazy for a few days or a few weeks. That was the only answer they were provided, and it made absolutely no sense and had no proof whatsoever to back it up. A man named Leon Armonier actually survived this whole phenomenon, but he did experience some of the symptoms, and he said that he would rather die than live it again. And he was placed in a hospital and straitjacketed in a room with a few teenagers who needed to be strained to the bed to keep from thrashing about, which didn't really stop them. They would scream at the top of their lungs. They would like hit things and try to get out so hard. He was terrified. And basically this haunts him every single day of his life, and this poor man still doesn't know why he had to go through that. But 2 years later, something even more suspicious happened. A man named Frank Olson committed suicide. Now, he was an American biochemist, but that wasn't all that he was doing at the time. He was working for the American military for special operations. And this basically meant he was in charge of all experiments, all programs, operations that were happening to benefit the military. Now, he had expressed a guilt of some sort and a depressive state after 1951 to his wife and just said that he couldn't handle what he had done, but didn't really give her any more specifics. And then in New York, he threw himself out of the 13th floor window at a hotel. So that's when a journalist came in to kind of look into the suicide and what really happened. And his name was Hank Alberelli, and he dug deep. What started off as a suicide investigation led to him obtaining documents from the CIA and the White House. And what he found scared him more than the fact that maybe this wasn't a suicide. From doing his intense research, he came to the conclusion that Pont-Saint-Esprit was the joint work of the American Army and CIA operatives, and that their village was an experiment to test the side effects of the hallucinogenic drug LSD. Among the many documents of proof that Hank found, one was found 3 years prior to this happening in 1951, so in 1949 was when this document was dated, and this was between a CIA operative and an American representative of Sandoz Laboratories, and that's where that name comes in again. In this transcript, it spoke of the secret of Pont-Saint-Esprit and that the ergot poisoning was actually, I'll put it on the screen, this drug, which is the D in LSD. So now the recantment that this could possibly have been a synthesized drug from the creator of synthesized drugs, now there was a reason why it was recanted. Now in 1953 to 1970, it said that there was a lot of these experiments going on behind the scenes because of the Special Operations Department in America. And this is because this was the Cold War, very dark years, and the Americans really believed that the soldiers were being taken prisoner in Korea and being brainwashed, and that they were about to fight a psychological and mental war, and they wanted to be ready. So they were testing all kinds of mental warfare, which would also include making an entire village insane. Now, because they still to this day haven't made any more moves in this case and haven't gotten any more answers, there are several theories that just the world in America and journalists and people that notice these things and are aware of it have come up with. And the first one is that a man named Sidney was the mastermind of this entire thing. Now, he was a military chemist and a secret operative, and he had previously shown his obsession with LSD when it first started coming to fruition. He wanted to drug a Cuban leader just to see how he could make him go mad. He was this kind of man, very messed up in the head, wanted to see how far he could take people. Didn't care, wasn't aware of the repercussion. And this man also wasn't opposed to testing drugs on people. He tested them on prostitutes, on prisoners of war, on students, anyone he could possibly get to volunteer, regardless of telling them the truth, regardless of the side effects that they could have. He didn't care about human life. He cared about getting answers and finding solutions and making his experiments work. But it's also been proven a little bit that neither LSD or ergot poisoning could have been the answer to any of this. And that is because ergot poisoning wouldn't have just affected one sack of grain in one village. If this was happening in one village, it would have been happening at all of the other villages around it, and it wasn't. This was contained in one single area. Nothing else happened outside. This wasn't a widespread plague type thing. One village, very confined and contained, like this happened on purpose. But it's also been proven now, or proven, I guess, that LSD does not have really the same symptoms that they were experiencing, but you do have to remember that drugs probably changed a lot since then, and maybe they were different back then. But it's also said that if LSD was put inside the bread, it wouldn't have survived the temperatures of the baker baking the bread. And later another theory came forward that possibly it was mercury poisoning, because that is sometimes found in the things used to treat the grain and the seeds that were used to make the bread. But still, to this day, nobody has a clear answer on what actually happened, besides possibly Frank Holson, who committed suicide, possibly from the guilt, or was murdered for wanting to say too much. And possibly the CIA or the American military know what happened, but to this day, the victims of what actually happened have no idea, and the general public has no idea. And it almost seems to me like this whole entire thing was meant to seem like one big hallucination itself. They had hallucinations within it, so maybe they weren't thinking correctly, you know, maybe all of this stuff didn't actually happen. And so we're left to believe that maybe they just all made it up. Maybe it was one big hallucination that never really happened. Or did it? Or was this one big experiment gone wrong? But the biggest theory I've found that people believe in now is that it was the CIA and this was a human mind control experiment because they wanted to test the effects of this drug and seeing how it would work on people to use it possibly as a weapon of war when they needed to get information out of people or to make people weak or to make people feel absolutely insane. I know that this is more of like a conspiracy theory type thing, but I read about these CIA experiments or CIA cover-ups and things that are hidden from us, and it just makes me so mad because we deserve to know these things and what's happening with the world, and there have to be better, more humane ways to test things to get permission to do so. What do you believe happened? Do you think it was just a mass food poisoning that just kind of went wrong and somehow made them hallucinate and do weird things? Do you think it was all a lie? Do you think that this was a mass experiment on purpose to possibly test things for the military? What do you think? And do you also think Frank Olson committed suicide? Or do you think he was murdered for what he knew? I think either way is really a possibility for him. I think if he was involved in this and it is as bad as we have come to the conclusion that it was, he could have had a lot of guilt or he could have wanted to come forward, and either way, it ended his life. Now the journalist Hank, who is the reason that all of this information has come more knowledgeable to us, he actually wrote a book about everything, exposing everything that he knows, and has risked a lot as far as his career, his safety. But he's risked a lot, and he actually wrote a book about all this knowledge, and I will link that down below if any of you are interested. But regardless of that, and him coming forward with all of this, the CIA, the government, nobody will come forward with the answers that we are pleading for and that the victims deserve. So it's very sad, really, in the end, that this happened, and many, many people went to their grave having no idea why. So I know that this is a little bit different than an unsolved murder or a case like that, but I think that these are equally as important because these are things in our world that we are not aware of, that happened in the past, that aren't allowed to be taught in schools. And if we have to sit through history class for 12 years and then possibly go to college for more, we should be told the whole truth and nothing but. Well, I guess on the grand scheme of things, it was murder, wasn't it? If it was the CIA, it was murder, but. So that's why I like to speak about these subjects. If you're the government, please don't kill me. This is all just a theory. I have no idea, no idea at all, but. If you do want more of these kind of videos that are more eye-opening, please give this a thumbs up. And if you like the way I told it, please give it a thumbs up. But that is it, and as always, if you have anything that you want me to talk about, leave it down below. I love suggestions. And yeah. And make sure to subscribe if you do like these videos and turn on the post notifications bell, because you don't want to miss another creepy video and what I could uncover next. I will let you guys go. Bye.
I don't believe in shying away from the hushed secrets of the world no one dares to say. Knowledge is power, but not too much. Don't go astray. Yeah, we're all wonderful, wonderful people. So when did we all get so cheerful? And now we're finally finding our voices. Just take a chance, come help me.